Last time I introduced the definition of charge conjugation, which means basically finding a solution satisfying the same equation but with opposite value of charge. And today we will see the explicit construction of this transformation in the case of Dirac equation. So I wrote down the Dirac equation here, and after charge conjugation, we want a transformed equation which has a plus sign in front of the a slash term. And that is the only difference. So now we want to find a relation between psi c, which is a charge conjugated wave function related to the original wave function psi. So the first step is to just change the relative sign between del slash and a slash terms, and that is accomplished by complex conjugation exactly the same way as it is done in the case of the Klein-Gordon equation. But here something else will happen, because the del slash and a slash operators involve gamma matrices, and they are not necessarily going to remain invariant under complex conjugation. So let us first write the complex conjugated equation. Which gives minus I h cross de mu minus E by C a mu gamma mu star, which I have to explicitly separate. So the relative sign between this d mu and a mu is flipped, and to get back to the original structure, now we have to transform this gamma mu star to a new object, which will take it back to gamma mu, but there is a negative sign to absorb from this del slash and a slash terms. So we define a new relation which conventionally is defined as a product of C times gamma 0, where C is some matrix and it has to satisfy the constraint that C gamma 0 gamma mu star C gamma 0 inverse produces minus gamma mu. So now if we operate on this whole equation by this matrix C gamma 0, it will give the equation of for psi C, and gamma mu star will get converted to minus gamma mu, which is exactly the form of the operator required when the sign of the charge is flipped. And so this becomes a definition of the charge conjugated wave function. The question is which kind of matrix will satisfy the particular transformation rule, and now that matrix can be constructed in a specific representation of the gamma matrices. In case of Dirac basis, we have the particular structure that gamma 2 is imaginary and gamma 0, gamma 1, gamma 3 are real. So, the operator should be such that when it acts on gamma 0, gamma 1 and gamma 3, the sign should change, but when it acts on gamma 2, the minus sign is already obtained by the complex conjugation. So, it should merely commute with gamma 2. Of course, we know such a matrix, and the convention is to, so then C gamma 0 is equal to I gamma 2 satisfies the required condition. So, in Dirac basis, we have an explicit construction that psi c is equal to I gamma 2 psi star obeys the condition. The I is used as a convention, and it is basically to ensure that the square of this matrix is essentially 1. And that is very easily seen, because gamma 2 when squared produces minus 1 due to the Minkowski metric signature, and I square is equal to minus 1, and that has become a standard convention. But other than that, that choice of phase, the rest of the structure is dictated by the commutation rule required to satisfy the change in sign. So, this is the construction of a charge conjugation operation in case of Dirac equation, and we can use it to construct solutions which actually correspond to positron. It is kind of implicit over here that, so off diagonal gamma 2 interchanges upper and lower components of the Dirac spinner. This is kind of necessary in our interpretation of antiparticles, which corresponded to the negative energy component of the Dirac spinner, and in the Dirac basis they were the lower components. If you wanted to bring the antiparticle degree of freedom by the charge conjugation operation as the actual solutions, you must interchange the upper and lower components, and so the transformation matrix is off diagonal in Dirac basis. So, this is the useful operation, and of course, we will connect it to the other symmetries which are parity and time reversal a little bit later in the course. Now, let me introduce another construction or an operator which is extremely useful, and that is a concept of what is known as chirality. At the heart of this construction is a particular fact that the number of n by n matrices obeying the anti-commuting Clifford algebra is actually n plus 1. So, we have been dealing with the Dirac equation, which had four matrices, all of them have dimension 4 by 4, but this general fact about Clifford algebra tells us that there has to be a fifth matrix, which will anticommute with all of the four matrices used in the Dirac equation. It is not very difficult to construct this matrix explicitly, and it has been conventionally labeled as a matrix gamma phi. Now, this phi is not a Lorentz index, it is just the fifth matrix, but it is used in the same sense as the other matrices with Lorentz index. And to avoid confusion, let me stress that whether you put the index up or down does not make any difference, but its definition explicitly is a product of all the other gamma matrices. And this definition ensures that gamma phi now will anticommute with any one of the matrices involved in this product. There are totally an even number, but when you take one of them and try commutation rule, it will commute with itself and not commute with all the rest. Since the total number is even, the ones which will anticommute are odd in number and you will get a anticommutation rule. So, gamma phi with gamma mu anticommutator is equal to 0. And this works in any dimension, as long as there are even number of them, you can always construct a next odd one by such a procedure. In case of 2 by 2 matrices, we have 3 Pauli matrices following the same rule. And the convention again is left to fix the phase of this particular matrix, and that is introduced here by a construction that gamma phi is a Hermitian and gamma phi square is equal to identity, and that fixes the overall phase of this particular matrix. So, this is a simple mathematical construction, but it has non-trivial physical meaning, and that is the concept of chirality, which now we will explore. To write down some simple relation, let us go back to the Dirac equation and construct certain commutators. So, first we know for the Dirac equation that the anticommutator of the Hamiltonian with the matrix beta just gives the rest mass, and similarly you can write an anticommutator with gamma phi, which gives now the alpha part, because gamma phi actually commutes with alpha. Alpha is a product of gamma 0 and a spatial gamma matrix. So, there are two anticommutation involved in commuting gamma phi with alpha, and that makes it commute. So, this picks up the other term of the equation, which can be now written as 2c gamma phi alpha dot p. And now we define this matrix gamma phi alpha by the symbol used earlier for the spin. This construction is a identity, because this is exactly what the spin matrices were defined to be. In Dirac basis, alpha was the off diagonal, sigma was the diagonal part, and gamma phi is nothing but an off diagonal identity matrix. So, it is very easy to see that the anticommutator of gamma phi with Hamiltonian produces the structure sigma dot p, but this operator sigma dot p has a meaning, and is the projection of spin along the direction of motion to be correct. It has to be a unit vector defining the direction of motion, and we have a name for it. It is called helicity, and since the orbital angular momentum is always perpendicular to the linear momentum, sigma dot p is also equal to the component of total angular momentum along the direction motion, and this object will be conserved in situations where the total angular momentum is conserved. So, it is a useful quantity to take into account, and it has a special name. It is called helicity. So, now this gamma phi matrix did produce this helicity structure, and we can give it a meaning explicitly by considering expectation values of these equations written above between eigenstates of the Hamiltonian. So, we have expectation value of the form that beta will give the value m c square divided by E, and by the same logic, this will give the expectation value of helicity operator scaled by the energy. Now, if we put in the explicit relation between momentum and energy, we can see that gamma phi is V by C times the helicity operator. It will become the helicity operator exactly when the particle is massless, so that V is always of the magnitude C. And many times this property of helicity is also called the handedness, whether the particle is right handed or left handed is decided by the component of its angular momentum along the direction of motion, and gamma phi therefore ends up measuring the handedness of the particle. So, this is the interpretation of what this gamma phi does. For the particular case of massless particle, we can actually do more things, and I will soon proceed to that. But before that, I also want to mention that the gamma phi can also be used, because of all this property, to construct a complete basis for the 4x4 Hermitian matrices, which appear in the Dirac algebra. There is a general definition of gamma phi, which can be written as the totally antisymmetric tensor multiplying the product of four gamma matrices. It produces the same result as product of gamma 0, gamma 1, gamma 2, gamma 3, and the summation of the indices produces a 4 factorial term, which is removed in the explicit normalization. And one can expand any 4x4 matrix can be written in terms of its 16 components, and we have a convenient choice given all these matrices, and that choice is labeled as the identity matrix. The 4 gamma matrices, then the 6 anticommutators of the gamma matrices, I have earlier called them sigma mu nu, then a product of the gamma matrices with gamma 5 and gamma 5. So, this basically gives the number 1 plus 4 plus 6 plus 4 plus 1, that adds up to 16, and it is often common to label these matrices by their transformation properties under Lorentz transformation, and that is labeled as a scalar, which is the identity, a vector, which is gamma mu, a tensor, which is sigma mu nu, an axial vector, which is gamma mu gamma 5, and a pseudo scalar, which is gamma 5. So, this is the property under Lorentz group transformation, and more generally we can look at it once we have some details about the Lorentz group, but it is at this stage quite straightforward to see that gamma 5 is a pseudo scalar. Since it gets a minus sign under parity, we have seen earlier that the matrix for parity transformation was gamma 0. So, we can use the transformation rule for parity transformation, and since these two anticommute it will produce minus gamma 5, and this flip of the sign tells us that gamma 5 is going to behave as a pseudo scalar, and that is a particular property implicit here. Now, product of a vector and a pseudo scalar will construct an axial vector with a same vector index, but the opposite sign of the parity, and a product of two vectors is going to construct a tensor. The details of this will appear in the Lorentz group classification when we come to it. So, this is one particular feature and basic definitions of gamma 5 and its use for classifying operators as well as relation to the helicity operator. There is another construction which is useful, and that is to use gamma 5 as a projection operator, and that is also a very general rule. Any matrix which squares to identity is a representation of reflection in some sense or the other, and if you have such a matrix, then you can easily construct projection matrices, which is 1 plus or minus that matrix, the whole thing divided by 2. So, depending on whether the associated reflection produced a plus sign or minus sign, the two eigenstates can be separated by that particular matrix, and we can use it for any matrix which squares to 1. And you can define projection operators for various cases. In particular, 1 plus or minus gamma 5 by 2 are projection operators for chirality projection operator. The property is the square of the projection operator should give the same matrix, and that is always ensured as long as the non-trivial matrix appearing here gamma 5 squares to 1. And then the other condition is that the sum of all the projection operators should end up being equal to identity. That means it just covers the complete space. But we can now write down many other projection operators also for the various states which we have used to label particles, antiparticles, the corresponding values of the spin, etcetera. And these can be easily constructed in race frame and then rewritten in a form which is Lorentz covariant. So, the projection operator for energy is essentially 1 plus or minus gamma 0 by 2 in the rest frame. So, the positive energy solutions will have the upper components and 1 plus gamma 0 by 2 as the projection operator, and the negative energy components will have the lower part of the spinner and 1 minus gamma 0 by 2 as a projection operator. And this is a structure which we explicitly put in the Dirac basis, and it was visible in the case of the race frame. So, this kind of structures where some particular matrix appears now can be converted in a covariant language, because in this particular case we have the rule that the 0th component of momentum is mc, and the three vector part is 0. So, this object which is 1 plus or minus gamma 0 can be rewritten in a Lorentz covariant form. You rewrite this gamma 0 as a dot product of P with a gamma matrix. In the race frame, it always has the standard form, because the spatial parts does not contribute, but once you have a dot product of P with gamma, one can construct a complete operator P slash, which has the same value in the race frame, but it is a Lorentz covariant structure, and so the projection operator for the two signs of energy is plus or minus p slash plus m c by 2 m c. The m c enters because I am using p 0 with the usual normalization, which is m c's, and so that everything is normalized properly. So, this is the way one can construct projection operators for various cases. One more projection operator is for the spin, and that also can be written as 1 plus or minus sigma z by 2 in the race frame with z axis as the measurement direction for looking at the spin. It has again the same structure, and now we can convert this sigma z again in some covariant notation, which can help. The first step is to take this non-relativistic sigma z and rewrite it as capital sigma z, which was the value for the spin for the Dirac equation. So, sigma z we will convert to this capital sigma z, which happens to be the same thing as gamma phi times alpha z, and that can be written as a dot product between the alpha matrix and the direction of measurement. So, now we have a structure where this dot product can be extended to arbitrary Lorentz frame, because that is a structure which is invariant. One more thing, it is necessary to rewrite this alpha matrix as a gamma matrices, which can be done by making this gamma 5 gamma z times gamma 0, which is the definition of alpha z, and then one can dot this gamma z with the unit direction to make it is a slash operator. So, which can be written as gamma 5, then z hat slash times gamma 0. Now, this is a structure where the covariant form in terms of the slash matrix is explicit, and there is an extra matrix gamma 0, but we will absorb the sign which is contributed by the gamma 0 in the definition of the spinner basis. So, an antiparticle will correspond to an opposite sign of the momentum, but we will also say that the antiparticle will correspond to an opposite value of the spin corresponding to the particle. With that particular notation, we can now define a projection operator for any direction and that direction now is denoted by this vector z, which now can be written as one plus or minus gamma z by 2, and with this e less than 0 giving opposite spin compared to e greater than 0. So, this is a convention which is useful in identifying antiparticles as absence of a negative energy particle. So, the absence flips everything including the spin, and this is a then becomes a covariant definition of the spin operator. There is one more thing one can do to generalize the specific space direction, which is useful for defining angular momentum only when the particle is at rest, to an arbitrary boosted direction, and then in general Lorentz frame, the spin gets extended to a 4 vector and not just the 3 vector in the rest frame, which gives the standard angular momentum. So, spin sigma becomes a 4 vector S mu. So, this was a vector in the rest frame, and this was a 4 vector, but just as there is a constraint on the spin because it had only 3 independent components in the rest frame, this also should have 3 independent components, and that can be imposed as a covariant condition, which is that P mu S mu is equal to 0. In the rest frame, there is P mu has only the 0th component, and so the S 0 vanishes, and that is equivalent to saying that there are only 3 spatial indices surviving to describe the spin. So, this is a more general definition of the spin 4 vector, and in terms of the 4 vector, we can easily generalize this value of sigma as well. So, sigma for an explicit vector S will now have a structure 1 plus or minus gamma 5 S slash by 2, and S will be a unit vector. So, its normalization in this covariant language is S mu is equal to minus 1. So, that is the general construction of various type of projection operators. One can easily construct them one by one from any matrix which squares to 1, and the projection operators for chirality, energy and the spin are the most useful one, and which I have explicitly constructed. Now, let us go back to studying this property of this projection operator corresponding to chirality in more detail, and in that case it is useful to go to a new equation which is obtained from Dirac equation using this projection operator, and that equation is called the Weyl equation. So, this is projected from the Dirac equation for massless particles. The massless particle is the characterizing feature. We already know that this projection operators which we constructed have a specific structure. In particular, gamma phi commutated with alpha but anti commutated with beta. So, with no beta m c square term in H, what we have is that the operators which we constructed as projection operator 1 plus or minus gamma phi by 2 commute. With the Hamiltonian, the gamma phi anti commutated with beta, and that is why we had to drop this term and consider the situation for a massless particle. But as soon as we have an operator which commute with H, we can give it an eigenvalue which is conserved, and since these are projection operators, the complete solution will be just decoupled in the separate sectors corresponding to different values of the eigenvalues. And we have seen that gamma phi measured the helicity of the particle, and for massless particle the helicity is basically just the projection of the spin along the direction of momentum, and it becomes automatically conserved. The fact massless plays a role in the sense that one cannot boost to a frame in which momentum will reverse the direction, and so sigma dot p will change its value. For a massless particle, the momentum cannot be reversed because you cannot go to a frame which is faster than the speed of the light. So, this becomes an important conserved quantities, and the eigenvalues of gamma phi, which ends up with commuting with the Hamiltonian, are plus or minus 1. And so, then the plus 1 value will be projected by 1 plus gamma phi by 2, and the minus 1 value will be projected by 1 minus gamma phi by 2. And we can then the two sectors decouple, and each can be described by a two component differential equation, in contrast to the Dirac equation which had four components. And these two decoupled equations, each having only two components, they are called the Weyl equation. And now we can explicitly construct them by choosing a convenient basis, and that basis is called the Weyl basis. It is constructed to make this decoupling explicit from the same Clifford algebra, and what it does is, compared to the Dirac basis, the definition of gamma 5 and gamma 0 are interchanged. So, gamma 0 becomes off diagonal, but the beta mc square term is absent from the equation, so it does not play any role. Gamma 5 is diagonal, which has specific eigenvalue. So, the upper components will have one eigenvalue and the lower component will have the opposite eigenvalue, and the other matrices which are needed to complete the equation are the alpha matrices, and they have the structure that they all have to mutually anticommute, and they can be chosen in this particular basis as sigma and minus sigma on the diagonal. The commutation rules can be very easily checked. In particular, gamma 0 and alpha are going to anticommute, and gamma 5 commutes with alpha. So, now we can write down the two decoupled form, and I can put a subscript w explicitly to avoid confusion. So, decoupled equations have the structure that the Hamiltonian operating on psi is going to be just alpha dot p, the beta part is absent, and alpha has two different values for the two different decoupled components. So, it is plus or minus sigma dot p times psi, and this basis makes it explicit that there are two signs of helicity. The sigma dot p operator is very explicit, which are appearing as two decoupled equations, and we will label this plus or minus sign conventionally. So, this plus or minus signs of helicity correspond to what are labeled as right-handed and left-handed particles. So, that is a easy solution or separation of the equation once you have made the objects massless. And so, this two component equation is useful in describing massless neutrinos. One should note that this R and L corresponding to the opposite signs of helicity are inequivalent representations. So, the set of sigma and minus sigma are inequivalent representations since sigma I sigma j is I epsilon I j k sigma k, but if you put a minus sign, the same algebra will not hold, or rather there will be an overall negative sign, and that is enough to say that this will obey one kind of relations, the other one will obey a different relation, and one cannot convert one of them to the other. So, these R and L are physically distinct objects, and they will have a different properties which can be measured by some clever experiment or the other, and we will use them in that particular sense experimentally . We find that both these objects do not exist, but only the left-handed neutrino and the right-handed antineutrino are observed. This means that out of the two particular equations, one corresponds to observed neutrinos and the other one is absent altogether. Why this is so is something which cannot be answered mathematically, it is just a property of nature, but mathematically there is no objection to having one and not the other, it just corresponds to that certain degrees of freedom are not physical. So, this separation of Dirac equation to Weyl equation projects according to the helicity, but the plus or minus energy components remain in two component Weyl equation. So, out of the four components, we have taken out the spin part essentially, or more correctly the helicity part, but left the plus or minus energy interpretation untouched, and so we still have the interpretation of a particle and antiparticle associated with the plus and minus signs of energy, and in particular this nu L and nu R bar, they behave as this positive and negative energy components. When one treats the absence of one as the other, the helicity also ends up flipping, and the conventional values for these things are just the same for a spin half particle. minus half and plus half. So, this is what one can easily do in case of separating the Dirac equation and finding the corresponding objects, label them by helicity, and we have a physical quantity which also describes them.